भवतु सहनं भुनक्तु सवीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै। शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। गुरुर्ब्रह्मा गुरुर्विष्णुः गुरुर्देवो महेश्वरः साक्षात् परब्रह्मा तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। समस्तजनकल्याणेनिरतं कर्मणा नमामि चिन्मयं देवं सद्गुरुं ब्रह्मविद्वरम्। ॐ पार्थाय प्रतिगोपितां भगवता नारायणेन स्वयं व्यासेन ग्रथितां पुराणमुनिना मध्ये महाभारतम् अद्वैतामृतवर्षिणीं भगवतीं अष्टादशाध्यायिनीं अम्बत्वामनुसन्दधामि भगवद्गीते भवद्वेषिणीं। यं ब्रह्मा वरुणेन्द्ररुद्रमरुतः सुन्वन्तिर्व्यैस्तवैः वेदैः साङ्गपदक्रमोपनिषदैः गायन्ति यं सामगाः ध्यानावस्थिततद्गतेन मनसा पश्यन्ति यं योगिनः यस्यां तं न विदुःसुरासुरगणा देवाय तस्मै नमः। So we saw the divine qualities in the 16th chapter, and also in one verse Bhagavan spoke about the demonic qualities, and then he said in the fifth one that the divine ones are those which liberate an individual and the demonic are the ones which bind the individual. This is in terms of the mind. The mind feels more stronger with divine qualities, and the mind feels dissipated, weaker with the demonic qualities. Now he goes on to explain the demonic ones in more detail. See, when we think of demonic qualities, we always think of the opposite of the divine. So compassion, then we think anger. Selflessness, something selfishness, like the opposite. But it's very interesting in the 16th chapter, in one verse Bhagavan gave the opposites already, that's over. But his focus is not on that. Focus is on the certain vision and attitude of life, which is the cause of the demonic qualities. So if there is selfishness, if there is greed, these are generally called as demonic qualities, telling lies, cheating, looting, murdering, demonic qualities. What is the attitude because of which these arise? These are called the Asuri Sampada. So now, many verses are dedicated now for examining those attitudes. And what are those attitudes, which if we have, demonic qualities will be a natural result of that. So at one level, one thinks that if I start following good values, I will become a good person. And one starts, which is fine, there is nothing wrong in that. But at a deeper level, one has to examine, do I have any of these attitudes? Because these are the cause for the demonic qualities. So now let us see what all he says. This chapter from shloka number 7, this starts. And Bhagavan goes on till twelve verses he gives. And then one also says, he also gives what happens as a result of these qualities. So let us see. The seventh one he says, Pravritimcha nivritimcha janana vidurasuraha. What to do and what not to do. Those who are asurid, they do not know how to discriminate between what is to be done and what should not be done. Meaning what is right and wrong, what is permitted and what is prohibited. Now one may say that, you see, in the state of confusion, and one is trying to get clarity in certain situations where one doesn't know what is right and wrong, what to do, like Arjun was in that state, no? He didn't know what to do. That is not indicated here. What is indicated here is the line between what is permitted and what is prohibited is not there. So permitted becomes prohibited, prohibited becomes permitted, that is, so there is nothing to hold and stand by. Whatever one feels like doing at any time one does. Today we find that increasingly happening, no? In that sense of there is nothing called right and wrong. So one does whatever one wants to do. One can give any justification for it, but that does not make a wrong into a right. Even a simple example of vegetarian and non-vegetarian. One can go on debating. And each side will have their own points. How to know what is right and wrong in that? There are many criteria. It may be different from case to case. That is not denied. But to understand that in this situation or this person in this case, this is the right thing to do, that is called vivek. So that those criteria must be applied. If we don't apply those and then just do what is not supposed to be done, unnecessarily kill animals and eat for the pleasure of the tongue, how much we harm the environment also, harm ourselves also, so many things happen. So this distinction is not known, first and foremost, that what is right, what is wrong, what is permitted, what is prohibited, pravrittimcha nivrittimcha. At a subtler level, pravritti and nivritti also mean when to act and when to withdraw. Meaning when not to act. And simplest example of that is when to give advice and when not to give advice. Pravritti and nivritti. When should I do action and when should I do meditation? That also is not known. When should I continue working and from when should I start withdrawing? Nivritti mark. First 50 years is pravritti mark, next 50 years is nivritti mark. But you see people, mahapravritti starts at 65-70. Some new thing, you know. Still one doesn't leave the control of the house, the family, the work, it goes on and on and on. Pravritti and nivritti, one doesn't know the difference. So these are attitudes. See, Bhagavan is not saying these people are bad people. He says these are the attitudes and this will lead to demonic values and this result of this will be like this. So it's like a statement of a fact. Second, he says na shaucham. Cleanliness they don't maintain. Both at body level, mind level. Na api acharaha. Good conduct, good values and good manners. Good way of talking, behaving, achara. Na satyam teshu vidyate. And they don't follow truth. So you cannot trust them. What they say, what they do, very different. So this is one verse where he gives three qualities. They don't know what is right, what is wrong. Or they choose not to follow what is right and wrong. Second, cleanliness is not there. Third, no proper conduct. Fourth is this honesty is not there, integrity is not there, trustworthiness is not there. That absence of truth, integrity in their character also, That also leads to the next point where he says asatyam apratishthante jaguda jagadavaranishwaram. They say that there is no truth in this world. There is no substratum of this world. The whole world has no God. So there is no creator of this world. There is no sustainer of this world. Then how did this world come about? Naturally, somebody says that there is no creator. Question will be, then creation came from where? He said, aparasparasambhutam kimanyat kama haitukam. It is just brought about by mutual union of various species and creation just going on. And what is the purpose of species coming together? Sense enjoyment and lust. Kama haitukam. Meaning there is no cosmic intelligence. Creation is a product of chance. People have come together, species have come together, nature is there, and there is mixture happening. And then this, you will find these, if you go deep into each of these verses, you will find each of these verses is a very, very strong school of philosophy. So there is a whole school of philosophy which only believes, that Darwinism believes in this, that there is no creation, and there is no God. This is evolution by natural selection. And species mingle with each other, and the survival of the fittest, and all that. And if one studies each of these, no, one will feel very convinced it is barabar.
It's in a textbook form, in school. We've learnt it, we've mugged it, okay. Given exams on that.
Okay. Nothing wrong with the principle of survival of the fittest. Okay. There's no wrong, no problem with that. But the fact which they say is that the whole creation, there is no creator because it is multiplication of the cells and the species, etc. that is happening. But the most fundamental point is, how did life come into that cell? That is still not answered. So in every branch, there will be one fundamental assumption which you have to question. And if you question that, then the whole theory collapses. Even in physics, that the particle, whether a thing is a particle or a wave, light is a particle or a wave also is not known still now. Now you say both also. And what is the most fundamental particle? And does it remain in that state all the time? That is also not answered. In every thing you will see, there will be one fundamental assumption. Physics also, chemistry also, biology also, everywhere. That has to be questioned. So right now here what he is talking about is this. Where there is natural selection happening, nature goes on, and there is no other higher purpose in this creation, there is no cosmic intelligence. According to that verse, these are the people who believe that there is no cosmic intelligence, there is no plan, there is no purpose. This is random. We just happen to pop into existence and pop out of existence. Over. What happens? See, we are not trying to judge anybody, that people who are non-believers are any lesser than people who are believers. These are attitudes which are being enlisted here. And what is the consequence of this attitude? If I believe that there is no purpose in creation, if I believe that there is no creator, if I think that is the ultimate purpose is only sense enjoyment, then my whole life will be like that only. And imagine a society which believes like this, that sense enjoyment is the only purpose in life. Beyond a point, where will there be harmony even in relationships? Because people will only use each other as objects for sense gratification. The higher need of an emotion, of belonging, of trust, of commitment, not there. That society will destroy itself. So that's the consequence of this. Gita does not say that if you are in any of these, that you are any lesser. This is a statement of a fact that this is what this attitude is all about. So he goes on to say that kama mashritya dushpuram. So sorry, ekam drishti mavashtabhyam nashtatmano alpabuddhaya. With this attitude when one lives very narrow-minded. Narrow-minded in the sense only for the body. Enjoyment of the body is my enjoyment. And that's the ultimate purpose. How animals live at the realm of the body. Even in animals, nowadays there are so many things whereby so many videos also they show, no? How animals are also, like Gurudev used to say, they have a fully developed mind, so they feel their emotions. A lot of the dog videos they go around. In Facebook, etc., if you see, so many dog videos are there. Lot of other animal videos also, there are dog especially. And really it's like indirect marketing. No? When you keep on seeing that, then you feel like mujhe kutta to chahiye. There's one nice video which says, who is the happiest when you come home? And there are so many dogs in that, you know, when that master comes home, the owner comes home, and the dog is sitting like that. When the owner is not there for many, many days, the dog is sad, and then that they have returned from vacation. Bapre, how much expression? Even animals, they express so much of emotion. So, even to say that you fall down to the level of animal, today it is a wrong statement. There one popular joke goes around, the monkey says that, don't insult me, I am not the ancestor of a human being. And t-shirt is there. People, that one monkey is telling the other monkey that you will grow up to become this. You don't want to become, say, why are you insulting me? So, if I live only at the sense pleasure level, body level, so he says, alpa buddhaya, I am not using my intelligence to inquire, to think. That buddhi which can make me know the cause of the whole creation and make me experience oneness with that cause of the creation, that buddhi I am not utilizing and living only at the body level. He says, nashtatmana, they have destroyed themselves. Alpa buddhaya, they are living in such small vision. Prabhavanti ugra karmana, and they act with such insensitivity. Kshayaya jagatovitaha, they destroy the universe. Meaning, if I have no higher purpose in life, the entire world is meant only for my sense enjoyment, I will not be sensitive enough to things and beings around. I will just use the world for my gratification. That's what human being is doing right now. How much we have destroyed this planet. And global warming and climate change is such a major issue now. In May, last year, this year, in May there were rains in Chennai. We have never experienced rains in Chennai in May. There was some snow in some Dubai a few months back. This climate change is so real now. Why? Because we have messed up with the environment so badly. So, why this thing happens? Because the whole purpose is, okay, this world is there to enjoy. If that is the mindset, then this is what will happen. So he says, kama mashritya dushpuram, dhamma mana madangita. So the whole purpose is only sense enjoyment. Then there will be dhamma, hypocrisy, mana, pride, mada, intoxication, that I am powerful, I am rich, I am whatever, so many different types of intoxications. Moha grihitva asad grahat. And they, in that delusion, they hold on to false things. Pravartante asuchivrataha. And they work with such impure intentions where it is only selfish. When we read this, now sometimes one will feel a reversion. What type of people are being described here? But remember again, Bhagavan is not branding anybody. Bhagavan is only saying that these attitudes exist and this is the consequence of this attitude. So he goes on. Chintam aparimeyamcha pralayantam upashitah. They are constantly engaged in worry. Till when? Till pralaya, till their death or, you know, this. They go on worrying. Pralayantam, at least in at death, Bhagavan has said their worries end. Means they end, they go on worrying till death. Kamo bhoga paramaha. Their supreme goal is only gratification, sense enjoyment. Etavaditi nichitaha, and they are very sure about it. This is straight jnana. The non-believer is very, very sure. But believer is very much shaking. But believer doesn't know if Bhagavan is, nahi hai, pata nahi kyun hai, and then one or two statements from science and anything comes, suddenly that faith is shaken up also. But the non-believer is very sure. There is no God, there is no better purpose. Eat, drink and be merry. And they will give precious advice also to people who are believers. Why are you wasting your time? Kisne dekha? Where is God? Which God? If your God was there, then there would not be so much suffering in the world. Something. And give advice also. Don't waste time in all this. There is only one life. Enjoy. Be merry. Be happy. Assumption there is by coming to spirituality, I am not enjoying. Assumption is that if I am coming here, then I am torturing myself. Or if I am coming here, then there must be some problem I have, that's why I am coming here for a solution. So many such assumptions. And they are sure, and they will give you advice also. Do this, don't do this. And one most precious advice that everybody gives is, do everything in moderation. Go for classes, but you know, two classes, three classes in a month is okay. Why are you not writing so many? Do in moderation. They are themselves not going to one also. They don't know what is the joy of coming to a class and evolving and all that. But nishchita, very sure. And so, Asuri Sambhara. They will tell you also, don't take life so seriously. Enjoy. It goes on. Asha Pasha Shatai Bandha. They are bound with hundreds of desires. Meaning, those who say, I am free, I will do whatever I want, that is not true freedom. The ability to say to the mind, no, when there is an impulsive gratitude, that is true freedom. Otherwise, I am a freedom of my own, I am a slave of my own mind. Asha Pasha Shatai Bandha. Hundreds of desires bind them. I want to go here, I want to do this, I want to eat that, I want to be like that. Nothing wrong in any of the desire. But if my thinking is that desire, fulfillment leads to happiness, which is permanent, that is wrong. That's a wrong notion. Each of them will create more desire. So, asha, pasha, shatay, baddha, kama, krodha, parayana. And if there is asha, there will be lust, there will be krodha, anger. Kama, krodha, parayana. Ihante kama bhogartham, and to enjoy this sense pleasures. Anyayena artha sanchayam. They can even do wrong things to acquire wealth. Because if desire fulfillment is the only criteria in life for my happiness, then I want sense enjoyment for it. To get those sense enjoyment and a particular lifestyle and particular comforts, conveniences, even if I have to indulge in immoral practices, I will do. So he says, ihante kama bhogartham. For this particular thing, for enjoyment as the goal, one will not bother also to compromise with any values, integrity. One will do it. And one will do it as justifying it, that this is required. Anyway, there is no higher purpose. So what is wrong if I do this? Indulge. Now goes on to the greed part. See, already the adharma has been done to acquire wealth. Now he speaks about greed. So first he spoke about calm. Then he spoke also about growth. Now he speaks about lobh. So what does he say? Idam adya maya labdham. I have already attained this much. Imam prapsi manuratham. And that particular thing that I want, that also I am going to get very soon. Idam asti. This already belongs to me. Idam api me bhavishyati punardhanam. And that wealth is going to quickly come back to me. Come to me again in future. So this mindset of non-contentment. Already I have so much and I have still this much to get and that much I have to attain and this is what I have to acquire. Mind goes round and round in that. Yes. Again, nothing wrong in seeking prosperity. But if the mind is like this, where the mind goes round and round only behind these materials, and one does not have enough contentment to even be at peace and enjoy what one has. One enjoys temporary self gratification, again the mind goes out to do something. Then that is the problem. So the greed is the issue here. Lack of contentment is the asuri sambandha. Greed is the issue. Now to get all these, he says they can even go to the extent of destroying people. This asav maya hata shatru, this competitor I have destroyed. Hanishya cha apranapi, that competitor also I am going to destroy very soon. Ishwaroham, now he says I am the Lord. Aham bhogi, I am the one who enjoys maximum. Siddhoham, I am perfect as I am. Balavan, I am very powerful. And I am happy because I have all this. Each of this is a different attitude. Ishwaroham, I am the Lord. Like Hiranyakashipu said, no, I am the Lord. There is no Narayan. And he used to torture people who used to say Narayan. Those attitudes are also there. In the world, people have got tortured for taking the name of the Lord. Those non-believers have also tortured. So Ishwaroham, Aham Bhogi, I am the one who enjoys the maximum. Siddhoham, I have attained whatever has to be attained. There are these people who will never feel that they need to change or they need to correct themselves. Siddhoham, I am perfect. They will tell you on the face also, accept me as I am, otherwise go. I will not change. I am who I am, us. I always used to wonder, many times, you know, and as I was growing up, many of this convocation address or this, in a company, there's an award which somebody has received, that person is coming and addressing people. They will always say that, you know, learn, be an eternal student, always learn in life, don't ever give up learning. I used to wonder, what, is there anything you want to tell in this? Being again supposed to learn every moment in life. What is there to tell in this? Then I understood, you know, it is something to be told because somewhere the mind has got conditioned after finishing the education. And now I have learned. So it equates learning to that. And especially if one progresses up the ladder, then that attitude sets in more. Now I have been there, I know what it is, I have the experience, I know in and out of this whole thing. So one stops learning. So they always say, what is that word? Learning curve. So your learning curve must always keep rising. Here is somebody whose learning curve doesn't rise. Siddhoham, I am perfect as I am. There is nothing for me to learn, nothing for me to correct or change. Balavan, I am very, very powerful. I can do what I want, I can achieve what I want. Any means, that's the power that goes into the head. And this the person thinks is happiness. So he says, I am sukhi, I am happy. Now he says, the pride of belonging to a higher, a better dynasty. So he says, Adyoham, I am rich. Abhijanavan asmi, I am born in such noble family. Royal blood, like that. Who is there to compare with him? I am incomparable, very unique. Yakshe, I will do lots of rituals. Dasyami, I may do lot of charity also. Modishye, and I will also enjoy tremendously. Iti jnana, iti ajnana vimohitaha. and is completely deluded by this false pride, pride of dynasty, pride of a rich family, pride of what actions, even the ritual that one does, the dham that one does, all that has to be done out of humility. But here the person will do it out of what they call pomp, show, ostentatiousness. The essence of that thing is lost. So what is the result? He summarizes saying, Aneka Chitta Vibhranta. Their minds are divided, deluded by so many, many, many wrong notions. Aneka Chitta Vibhranta. Moha Jala Samavrata. They're completely trapped in delusion. Prasanta Kama Bhogeshu. Very attached to sense enjoyment. What happens to these people? Patanti Narakeshita. They fall into hell. Now, whether you believe in a hell physically or not, that's your choice. But the mind getting disturbed is definitely a sign of this hell. Imagine a mind which is not peaceful, which is filled with endless desires, and which always is extroverted. Compromising, breaking values, breaking hearts of people. That is the Vasudeva Sambhara. So here he says, such people, Atma Sambhavita Stabdha, they are cheating themselves only. They are not cheating anybody more than they cheat themselves. They are cheating themselves. Why? Because the human potential which is there to realize the divine wasted. They are cheating themselves. And if they say that by doing any of this I will get away, they are cheating themselves from the second thing, which is law of karma. Karma will not spare. If I have broken values, I have not followed righteousness, it will catch up with you. Karma is like that. So it is only self-cheating. Atma Sambhavita, Stabdha. They are what we call very stubborn. They won't budge. Dhana mana madanvita, filled with pride of wealth and achievement. Yajante nama yajna iste. Even the yajnas which they do, spiritual practice, is done for popularity, nama yajna. That people should know that he is a very religious person and does lot of charity, does many big, big rituals. Yajante nama yajnaste dambhena avidhi purvakam, and they with their pride will not even follow the vidhi of doing the ritual. Typical example is marriage. In literally say panditji bhagao, reception ka der gaya bhagao, literally. It is good thing now that in some places they actually make people sit down, they give them the shlokas, the meaning, and they call only few people who are not interested in socializing, and then do the marriage ceremony properly, and then for reception they call everybody. That's a good thing happening now. Otherwise, rituals, you do a graha shanti also. They are more interested in people coming and them serving them, rather than actually doing the graha shanti in the way it should has to be done. Or graha pravesh, sorry. Graha shanti is the planets. Graha pravesh. The whole purpose of the ritual is that I am installing the Lord in the house. This is the house of the Lord, and I am a servant of that Lord, and I am doing the graha pravesh with this attitude. That's the purpose. But most of the time it is ulta. In the house, Bhagwan is in one bonvita box somewhere. This is my house. I built it with my effort so many years, and I have called all of you here, and I am giving, it's going to serve food and delicacy and whatever. That is called nama yajna. Doing it for the sake of social status. And now that social network is so active, that ritual though is forgotten. One is more interested in taking the picture first. Picture though or dialogue? And how many likes have come? Somebody put this picture, a lot of this picture they put. The house is on fire and the fellow is running down the staircase, standing, taking a selfie and putting on Facebook. Are you, house is on fire? Run out first. The, how much craze for that? Selfie. Do you know people lose their lives because of selfie? Terrible. Can you imagine? Going on a peak, last year only, this one group went for trekking. Five people, huh? Young boys and girls. And they are walking on the edge of the mountain. They are trying to cross one mountain to another. Walking there, it's very dangerous there already. In that, this one fellow said, let us take a selfie. And they lifted and not everybody is coming in selfie because they all are standing like this, you know, close to the mountain, holding hands of each other. The last fellow there moved, gone, all of them. Tragic. Just because of that. That is all this, where the popularity is so much required. Nama Yajnese. So he says, finally, ahankaram balam darpam, they are full of ego, power, darpa, haughtiness, kama, and selfishness, krodha, anger, samshita, their mind is filled with these. Mamatma paradeheshu, in themselves and in others, what do they do? Pradvishanto abhyasunyakaha, they go on finding faults. They are never happy with themselves, they are never happy with others. Fault finding is such a big, you know, exercise that one goes on indulging. Finding flaws about oneself and beating oneself down. Bhagavan says that is asuri sankara. And finding fault with others. See, noticing some mistake and pointing out or correcting is a different thing. But there are some people, so the word asuya means this. Finding fault even in that which is good, that is called asuya. Anasuya means seeing good even where there is fault. Atri Rishi's wife is called anasuya. Anasuya means even in that where there is a fault, they will only see the good. Asuya means even where there is good, they will see only fault. Abhyasuyaka means their mind is always on a fault finding mode only. There are some people who are like that. And that clearly shows that they are not happy with themselves. It will just come out, they will go on finding fault with somebody or another. If nobody, Modi ji is ready, he will have it. Somehow in our country today, for everything he is only blamed. Small little things. Arre, but that's not the job of the Prime Minister, there are other people to do. So, abhyasuyaka, go on finding faults. Now, having said all these, now he says something very, maybe surprised. Bhagavan says, what happens? What does he do with these people? He says, tan aham dushata kruram. These people who are hating others, who find fault with others, who are like all this described, kruram, they are so cruel means aggressive or cruel. Samsareshu naradhaman, they are the lowest among the beings in this world. Kshipami ajasram, I just throw them. Where? Ajasram, ashuman, asurishu eva yonishu. I put them again and again in asuri yoni. Meaning they will be born in this type of realm only. So if you believe again that there is those realms of consciousness which are there, higher realms of consciousness is where one evolves. Middle is the earth, where we are at human. Lower is the Asuri Yoni. Remember, Asuri Yoni is not plant, birds, animals. Huh? Asuri Yoni is below plant, birds and animals also. They are creatures which are below this normal species which is there in this creation. So they will have weird bodies. Somebody doesn't have a head, somebody has only stomach, somebody has eyes in the head, stomach, something like very weird type of creatures. Asuri Yoni. He said, I will put them into those yonis. Now Bhagavan is not punishing them, but he is stating a fact that if you live like this, this is the environment that you invite, and this is what will happen to you. Like if fire says that if anybody touches me, I shall burn them. Is it a curse or is it a statement of fact? It's a fact. Because that's what will happen. If you touch fire, you will get burned. So Bhagavan says here that if this is the way one lives, where one wants to live as an asura, where one doesn't want to use the buddhi, one doesn't want to follow values, one doesn't want to be sensitive, and one wants to destroy the potential, he says, I will just throw them into Asuri Yoni. To evolve from Asuri Yoni to the normal Yoni, millions of years it takes. So he says, Asuri Shweva Yoni Shu, Asuri Yoni Mapanaha, Mudha Janmani Janmani. Life after life after life they will spend in that. Maam Apraapyeva Kaunteya Tato Vyanti Adhamam Gatiyam. They will not attain me with this mindset. Many, many lives it takes to purify them, to purify themselves, and then they come up to the normal level, whether it is plant, bird, animal, whatever the karma, according to that one comes, and then comes to human, and then starts evolving further. So he says, this is what will happen when a person lives in Asuri Sampada, with this kind of extroverted mindset, without bothering about anything which will make the mind strong. When one lives like this, is what will be the situation. Now he says, if this is not enough, he goes on. Suppose one loves hell and one says, please tell me, I want to go to hell. How to go? Bhagavan gives the door. He says that if you say none of these three also, you know, none of this quality that you have listed, I don't have these qualities. But will I suffer? Then Bhagavan says, yes, if you have, there are three sure gates to hell. This is a very nice verse, let us chant this 21st verse. Trividham narakasyedam dvaram nashanam atmanah kama krodhastatha lobhah. Tasmade tatrayam yaje. So he says, Trividham narakasya idam dvaram. These three are sure gates to hell. You can try any one that you like. Or all the three also, at one shot also one can try. What are these gates? They will destroy your peace. Nashanam atmanam. These gates are what? Kamaha. Selfishness, krodha, anger, lobha, greed. Any one is enough to destroy the peace of human being, anyone. Just imagine lobha, how much people have and still there is no contentment in them. And more one is breaking the rules to get more and more. What was said in the Gita this sometime back, that's what is happening. Because the mindset is low. I have this, I want this, I still need this, I still have to get that. Low will not allow one to rest in peace. Anger, all of us know. Moment anger comes, disturb. And the cause of that anger is selfishness or some attachment, calm. So any of these three, One can experience hell here and now. One doesn't even have to go anywhere else. So if a person, even if the person doesn't have those attitudes which are given earlier, of an extroverted person or a non-believer, of an immoral person, even then, even for a righteous person, these three are sure gates to hell. No, no, but how can we live without these three? Some enjoyment we must have. So Bhagavan already said in the 7th chapter that calm by itself is not a problem. But the calm that violates dharma, that is a problem. He earlier said, dharma viruddha bhuteshu kaam vasti bharat rashima. I am that enjoyment which is devoid of any adharma. Whatever is a dharmic enjoyment, and when it is done in moderation, there is no problem with that. One doesn't get attached to that, and one doesn't get drained out by that, when it is remaining in dharma and in moderation and in control. Anger also comes now and then. A person slowly evolves out of attachment, then anger also will start reducing. And greed, definitely the false notion one has to throw out of the mind that I cannot grow without greed. Without greed I will grow more and I will grow much better and more secure. And out of inspiration I will grow. Greed is not required. But somehow the mind today is conditioned. Each of these three, kama, krodha and yoga, are justified today. We teach our children this. We teach our children to become selfish. And we tell them, if you don't become selfish, you cannot succeed. We teach them anger must be used. And anger is a sign of power. And we teach them greed is good. Don't be content with what you have. So what are we doing? From childhood, we are opening the gates of hell for them. We ourselves suffer in that hell. And then we open it for them also. Yeah, come, come. The child is by itself so happy. So if the mindset of ours can change, Bhagavan, that's why he says here that all these three are sure gateways to hell. Any one of these is enough. And these are not exclusive. They are coming as a package deal. If there is kama, there will be krodha and lobha. If there is krodha, there will be kama somewhere. Otherwise, krodha is not possible. And if lobha is there, the other two will definitely be there. So they all come together. Now, what is the way out of this? So, one thing here is, this Asuri Sampada started with not knowing what is pravritti and nivritti, and then it goes on after that. So, this 16th chapter ends with this two beautiful verses, that what is the state of somebody who does not follow this time-tested knowledge whereby the mind can be lifted. And then what is the state of somebody who follows that? So 23rd verse is, Yaha Shastra Vidhi Mutsrujya, who overthrows or overlooks the time-tested wisdom, which is the scripture and the Shastra, and Vartate Kama Karata, acts on one's own whim and fancy and licentiously, Nasasiddhima Vapnoti, that person will not attain the highest goal of happiness, supreme happiness. Na Sukham, nor temporary satisfaction here, Na Paramgati, nor Moksha. So the person will fall from both here and hereafter. That a person has to know. So this is not like if you don't read the scripture you will fall. This is not saying like that. It's like saying if I don't understand law of gravity and then I jump from somewhere, what will happen to me? I will perish from you. It is like that. So if I don't know the time-tested wisdom of how to safeguard myself from demonic qualities, and if I don't follow those qualities which are very divine, then I will not attain that goal of human life. Now if somebody says, it's okay, I don't want to attain any of this, I am happy the way I am, okay. There is no compulsion here. It's each one's choice. But if one is able to follow, this word Shastra is very, very powerful. Shastra means that which protects. Shastri iti Shastram. That which instructs. And Shasana Trayate iti Shastram. That which protects by its instruction. That is called Shastra. By following that, I am protected. From what? From my own impulsiveness. From my own ego. From my own wrong attitudes. Shastra is followed not for somebody else. Shastra is followed for oneself. So here he says this. That if I follow the Shastra, one is that it is a time-tested knowledge. Second is it is complete by itself. It is philosophy plus the ritual. So the knowledge plus the practical part, Shastra tells. Shastra will always give an advice which is unbiased. So if I go by the duty, if I go by the principle of the Shastra, that is the criteria to know something is right or wrong, so that I come to a right decision. Because Shastra will tell you, these are the points to consider, universal welfare, maximum good, it should be in line with your temperament, all those points will be there. Your stage of life, role of life, all those. And according to that, come to a decision. Now, if that is followed, becomes so easy to act in the world. Either one has to follow the scripture and follow the path. Or one must have the ability to arrive at those conclusions which will help that person to distinguish very clearly right and wrong, keeping the good of oneself and the others in mind, and then follow that. You know, the word Shastra, people always think about it only as spiritual textbook. But it is not like that. Literally, the word Shastra means that which instructs. So if I read the textbook of physics, then what am I reading? Physics Shastra. If I read chemistry textbook, I am reading chemistry Shastra. And do we even question that much? I am not saying we should not question our scriptures. But I am saying that we follow Shastra in other fields, but when it comes to spirituality, then one doesn't want to follow the Shastra. If something is being told which is not relevant, not applicable, which was very outdated, which is no more required now, one can still ignore all that. But Shastra is talking about the mind, which is applicable even today. About my own likes and dislikes, about my own impulsiveness. So one has to learn to follow those instructions. If it is said that the speed of light is this much, do we actually test? Somebody said no. And they have wrote it down. And we believe the speed of light is this. That we are not questioning, that we are not testing. But that also is a Shastra only. But because the knowledge is there, it is time tested, it is accepted, so much building further has happened. Science also has grown on that foundation. So if I follow the scripture, so this chapter ends with this a very beautiful advice. This shloka by itself is very powerful. Especially when I want to know what is right and wrong, this is the advice it gives. Tasmat Shastram Pramanam Te Karya Karya Vyavasthitau Nyatva Shastra Vidhanoktam Karma Kartum Iharhasi. He says Tasmat, hence, what is the authority to know what is right and what is wrong, and what I should do, what I should not do, to gain the knowledge of whether there is a creator or not, or how to be selfless. What do I follow? If I don't want to live in Aswarik way, what do I follow? It's a Shastra Pramanante. Shastra is a valid means of knowledge. Praman means a valid means of knowledge, not an invalid means of knowledge. Very important it is when we gain knowledge to choose the valid means. If I don't choose the valid means, my knowledge may be incomplete or even wrong. So if I want to see something, what is the valid means of knowledge? Eyes. If I choose my ears or my nose to see something, will I get the knowledge of the form? I don't get it. What is the valid means of knowledge if I want to look at, you know, stare in the sky and find out about this stars and comets and planets? I need a telescope and I need to find out what is the range of that telescope. Beyond a particular range, again I can't see. If I take my microscope and start seeing, how will I see? If I use a telescope to see what is inside a cell, knowledge will not arise. Now I want to know, why should I follow values? I want to know God is there or not there. I want to know, why should I be selfless in this world? And I don't want to open the scripture and study, and I am using some random means of knowledge. I don't know why a particular ritual is done, why some puja is done, why japa should be done. I don't know, and I am not opening that book, which is a valid means which will tell me. Then how will I gain that knowledge? So he says Shastra Pramanante. Hence you should consider the Shastra in this field of spirituality. The scripture is a time tested wisdom. And I am talking right now for Hindu scriptures, the Vedic knowledge, which has adapted itself to times and the principles that the Vedic rishis have given, they are applicable even today. External form has adapted itself to time, but the principles are same. So tasma shastram pramanante karya karya vyavasthitav. In finding out what should be done and what should not be done, jnatva shastra vidhan uktam, first gain the knowledge, karma kartum niharasi, then you should act. In our case, the situation is ulta. We start acting first, then we get nicely kicked in the world, and then we come, Gare Bhai, where is the Shastra? Please, please, give me the book. At least let me read what is the Gita saying and let me start living that. But doesn't matter, even that way we have still at least come to the Shastra, and once we learn, then we start changing our life and we start applying. So the last line is very important. Jnatva Shastra Vidhan Uktam. What is written in the scripture, I have to know. If I want to know how does the iPhone work, I have to study the manual of the iPhone. Even a simple thing, if I don't know, like how many volts or amps of power does it require, and I go and put in that main big industrial power supply, that type of a plug point, put, what will happen to the phone? In the case of phone, at least I can say, oh God, I get another phone. And be careful after that. In case of human body, what happens? Human life, precious life, time goes like this. Where is the time to experiment? There is no time to experiment. Then some people have already done the experiments, drawn the conclusion, and thousands of people have lived it also. Then why should we not open it and study what is written there? So the solution for Asuri Sampada is, if I want to get out of this type of a mindset, open the book, study, and start living according to what the Shastra says. Because simplest thing that Shastra does is, it will discipline the mind, it will train the mind. That's the main purpose of the Shastra. And that disciplining and training, when if it is taken up voluntarily, then the person evolves faster. If it is forced, even then the person will evolve if one is following it, but it will be slow. Like how we voluntarily submit to disciplining in a gym or something where we want to lose weight or improve our fitness. That way one has to follow. So that's where the 16th chapter ends. And this 16th chapter, when Bhagavan has said this, that one who follows the vidhi of the Shastra and acts, that person is doing the right thing, and one who doesn't follow, that person destroys himself. So now Arjuna has a question. So 17th chapter will begin with that question of Arjuna, and very practical question. So that we will take up in our next week. Next week, Tuesday, Wednesday and Thursday, 17th chapter. 17th chapter. 17th chapter. 17th chapter. 17th chapter. 17th chapter.